James was baptizing several people in the river on a Sunday, late in the afternoon. After baptizing several people, James asked if the crowd, is there anyone else who would like to be baptized? It was at that time that a very intoxicated man came stumbling down the river bank, down to the river, and waded out to James. James wasn't quite certain what to do with this intoxicated man, but or what he was even doing, and he finally just looked at him and asked him, sir, are you ready to find Jesus? The intoxicated man was taken back by the question, and he almost sobered up. And he goes, well, preacher, I suppose I am. And he tried to hand his bottle of alcohol to the preacher. The preacher wasn't quite sure what to do with that. Never had a person hand him his bottle of alcohol right before getting baptized. He wasn't quite sure what to do with it. But he got somebody from the crowd to come out and get the bottle and hold it while James took him back out in the river. And James asked him, are you ready to find Jesus? I suppose I am. So James baptized the man. He pulled him up and says, have you found Jesus? Intoxicated man wiped his face, shook his head. Nope, I didn't. So James took him and he shoved him back under the water and held him a little longer. Pulled him back up out of the water and says, now have you found Jesus? Man sputtering and trying to figure out things, wiped the water out of his eyes and goes, no, I still haven't. So the preacher took him and just held him underwater and held him underwater until bubbles started coming up, until he started struggling and fighting with him. And finally, he pulls him back out and he says, now have you found Jesus? Intoxicated man, sputtering water, coughing it out, spewing it out of his mouth, rubbed his water out of his eyes and said, well, I still haven't. Are you sure this is where Jesus fell in? You know, there's plenty of misconceptions about baptism. Apparently, James didn't think it was very important for the man who was being baptized to know or understand what they were doing. But that's not a biblical teaching. In the Bible, people knew what they were doing when they were getting baptized. Today, I want to, as we start this new series, Here He Comes. We're looking at a lot of different things in the life of Jesus where Jesus comes in a situation. And we're going to start out, first of all, with Jesus coming to John the Baptizer to be baptized. And so we're going to be beginning with prayer. We're going to be looking at Matthew chapter 3, Mark chapter 1, Luke chapter 3, and John chapter 1. I don't know how you're going to hold your Bible open to that. I've got a Bible program that keeps all four chapters there and keeps me looking at it. But first, let's start with prayer. Lord, I am so thankful for your love. I'm thankful for the blessings you have given to us. And I ask, Lord, that as we look at this, we understand why Jesus came to be baptized and what the purpose is. And Lord, help us to really understand this. Help us to make sure that we aren't just trying to hold people underwater, but we want to make sure that we're doing it for the right reason. In Jesus' name, amen. There are four main thoughts I want us to consider today looking at this. And the first one really comes from John's statement. When John, in several passages, said, there is one who is coming. One is coming. Matthew, Mark, and Luke all begin with the ministry of John the Baptizer, who was sent ahead of Jesus the Messiah. All three quote Isaiah the prophet and declare the voice of the one crying in the wilderness, make ready the way of the Lord, make his paths straight. John's ministry was to prepare the people for the coming Messiah, to turn the people's hearts back to the Lord and get them to ready to hear the message of God as coming through the Messiah Jesus. The gospel writers share with us how unusual John was. For instance, he had a diet. What was his diet? Locusts and wild honey. Now, catching locusts probably wasn't that big of a deal. Most of us have probably caught locusts, caught grasshoppers. If you ever tried to eat one, they're not real flavorful. I mean, they're flavorful, but you won't like it. It's extremely bitter. And then wild honey. Man, that tastes good, but do you realize what you have to do to get wild honey? You have to get into that hive and get into there. And there's probably some things, little creatures that will not like you getting into their honey. And I can imagine what it was like to have John going in there trying to raid that. It also tells us he wore a different garment. He wore a garment of camel hair with a leather belt. Not exactly a lot of protection against the bees that he was raiding their hives of. He would have been a sight to see, an unusual person. Probably had bee stings on him quite often where he was trying to get the wild honey. And he would have been really a different person. The interesting thing is the Word of God lets us know that he was sent before Jesus. And he's the first prophet for basically 400 years. And John's message was very simple. John was preaching repentance. In fact, Matthew records for us that when John saw many Pharisees and Sadducees coming out to be baptized, John cried out to them, "You brood of vipers, who warned you to flee from the wrath to come? Therefore, bear fruit in keeping with repentance. And do you not suppose that you can say to yourselves, 'We have Abraham for our father'? For I say to you, from these stones, God is able to raise up children for Abraham. The axe is already laid at the root of the trees. Therefore, every tree that does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire." John's main focus, his preaching, was about repent. To turn back to God. Stop your sinning. And when he saw the hypocritical religious leaders coming out as everyone else was coming out to be baptized, John called them out. "Hey, you got to repent. You have to repent." Luke records for us the reaction of the general population when John rebuked the religious leaders, telling them they needed to repent. The crowds then questioned John and said, "Well, then what shall we do?" And he would answer and he would say to them, "The man who has two tunics is to share with him who has none. He who has food is to do likewise." Some of the tax collectors coming out to be baptized said to him, "Teacher, what shall we do?" And he said to them, "Collect no more than you have been ordered to collect." Some of the soldiers were also questioning him, saying, "And what about us? What shall we do?" And he said to them, "Do not take money from anyone by force or accuse anyone falsely. And be content with your wages." His message was mainly repent. Change your ways. Stop doing what's wrong. His message wasn't just get baptized. His message started out with repent. Change your ways. Stop your sin. Start doing what's righteous. Start doing what pleases the Lord. And later on, when Peter stands up on the day of Pentecost in Acts chapter 2, he sounds a lot like John because he says, when the people ask, "What shall we do?" he starts out saying, "Repent and let each one of you be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ." Repent, repent, repent. If you refuse to repent, then baptism's just getting wet. It's holding some guy under saying, "Have you found Jesus yet?" And he's going like, "Are you sure this is where he fell in?" He had no clue what was going on. There has to be a repentance. And so John was sent ahead of Jesus, the Messiah, preaching repentance. And John was baptizing all who would repent. I find it interesting that Matthew writes this, starting in verse 5 of Matthew chapter 3. "Then Jerusalem was going out to him, and all Judea, and all the district around the Jordan, and they were being baptized by him in the Jordan River as they confessed their sins." Mark writes, starting in verse 5 of his chapter, Mark 1, "And all the country of Judea was going out to him, and all the people of Jerusalem, and they were all being baptized by him in the Jordan River, confessing their sins." And Luke writes, "And when all the people were baptized." John's ministry here has been about repentance, preaching that. But it reaches beyond there. And he's down at the Jordan River and he's baptizing people. And it says that all of those in Jerusalem and Judea, the surrounding area of Jerusalem, and the surrounding area of that of his ministry, probably on both sides of the Jordan River, were coming out to him to be baptized in the Jordan River. And I find this really interesting, especially because I've had many people object to baptism. And they tell me, "Well, the thief on the cross was never baptized." And I'm going like, "Really? You know where he was crucified? Jerusalem. You know where he probably lived? Jerusalem or Judea?" And it tells us earlier that all those in Jerusalem and Judea were going out to John and being baptized. There's a very strong possibility that thief on the cross, both of them, had been baptized at one time. Maybe he didn't stay true to his repentance. There's a lot of people who get baptized and aren't true to their repentance. But if the Bible's correct, and I believe the Bible is correct, there's a very strong case that the thief probably had been baptized. And so if you were objecting to baptism because you'd believe the thief was never baptized, well, you might be standing on quicksand instead of the solid rock of Jesus. John preached about one who was coming, and he was sent ahead, the Jesus, the Messiah. He was preaching repentance. He was preaching that everyone should be baptized, and he was baptizing them if they would repent. Then Matthew, Mark, and Luke all share with us that Jesus came to be baptized. Although every Jew was required by law to go to Jerusalem 3 times a year, the gospel writers don't tell us that Jesus was just traveling through the Jordan area and happened to come across John and John's preaching ministry. Instead, it distinctly states that Jesus came from Galilee to be baptized. Now, depending upon what commentary you read, various scholars say that Jesus would have had to travel roughly 65 to 70 miles one way from up there in Galilee down to where John was baptizing people. That was not jumping into your air-conditioned car and driving an hour and a half through the desert to where John was. That was most likely walking across the desert through dry areas along the Jordan River, over rocks, through dirt, whatever weather they were experiencing that time, possibly hot, possibly windy, possibly cold. Maybe it was mild. But when was the last time that you ever wanted something so bad that you were willing to walk 65 to 70 miles to get it? Yep, that's the same time I did it too. But Jesus did. He didn't even put it off and say, you know what, I'll be making a trip down to Jerusalem. I'll just combine the trips. It tells us that he started out and he went there for this purpose, a special trip at the start of his ministry years. And he went down to John to be baptized. John saw this as an event that was absolutely important. And he didn't just, if you want to, you can do it, if it's convenient and you happen to be going by John. No, this was so important that the scripture tells us he set off from Galilee down to John to be baptized by him. 65 to 70 miles walking. I find it interesting that as Jesus nears John, John objected to baptizing Jesus. Matthew records John as saying, I have need to be baptized by you, and you come to me? John immediately recognized Jesus as the coming Messiah, the one he had been preaching about, the one who is coming, the one of whom John said, I am not worthy to untie his sandal, the one that has existed before John. And he's the Almighty One. The Holy Spirit was revealing truths to John, and he immediately recognized Jesus as the one who did not need to repent, for he was sinless. And he knew that I'm the sinner. And if someone needs to be baptized for the cleansing of sin, it's me, not Jesus. So John objected to baptizing Jesus. However, Jesus persisted on being baptized. Jesus told John, permit it at this time, for in this way it is fitting for us to fulfill all righteousness. Now that Greek word, diakonsin or something like that, I can't really pronounce it and I don't speak Greek. It literally means being in accordance with God's law, that word righteousness. It means being in accord with God's law. And so Jesus was declaring to John that Jesus needed to be obedient to God in every aspect, in all of God's laws, so there is no other option, but Jesus needed to be baptized. And if Jesus doesn't get baptized, then Jesus would be disobeying God, and that would make him, what happens if you disobey God? You are sinning. And if Jesus had sinned, he couldn't be the sinless life to die for our sins. So Jesus is telling John, I have to do this to fulfill all righteousness, to be obedient to the law of God. I have to do this. And he needed to be sinless so he could lay down his life for us on a cross so that we could be covered by the blood of a perfect, sinless Lamb of God. Being baptized in Jesus' eyes wasn't just an option if you want to do it. It's a good thing. It required Jesus. Jesus said, I'm required to do this to fulfill righteousness, to obey God and God's laws. I know there's people who want to argue that baptism isn't necessary, but I don't want to argue with them. They can take that up on the day of judgment. I'm not going to do that. In the meantime, I'm going to preach what God's word says. And yes, it is necessary according to the scriptures. And if you read Peter's writing in 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 21, he very simply puts it, baptism now saves you. Not a removal of dirt from the flesh, but an appeal to God for a clean conscience by the resurrection of Jesus Christ. It's right in there along with the blood of Jesus saves us. Faith saves us. Grace saves us. God's love saves us. Jesus' death saves us. Every part of the scripture aspect that says saves us, one of those is baptism. And if God's word says it, that settles for me. I don't need anything else. John had been preaching. There was one who was coming, and John was sent ahead of Jesus, the Messiah, preaching repentance, baptizing all who were willing to repent. Jesus made a 65 to 70 mile one-way trip from Galilee down to be baptized. John objected, but Jesus persisted on the basis that to fulfill all righteousness, to be obedient to God, I must be baptized. And so we read, Jesus was baptized. Although none of the gospel writers tell us that Jesus went down into the water, both Matthew and Mark point out that Jesus came up out of the water after John baptized him. So to me, I believe it's a safe assumption that they both went down into the water and he came up out of the water. That's an indication of what baptism is about. And if you don't like to look at the actual Greek word, baptizo, that's exactly what it means. It literally means to dip, to plunge, to immerse. I thought it was very interesting, this new Bible program you guys gave me for being here 20 years. It talks about this very aspect. There's a different word, bapto, that means just to instantly go under and come right back up and nothing else. But baptizo implies the fact that when you've been dipped, plunged, or immersed, you come up changed. Like the dyeing of fabrics, that you dip it into a dye and it comes up different, changed. I thought that was very interesting because I had never heard that until recently when I was looking in this new program you guys gave me. Thank you very much, by the way. I really appreciate that program. But here it was, this aspect here, and you read in the scriptures over and over about baptism, and it's going down. In Acts chapter 8, Philip and a Ethiopian eunuch are riding in a chariot going across the desert. What do we do here in the desert anytime you get in your vehicle and you're traveling across the desert? What do you take with you? Water. I am certain that they're smart enough to realize they needed to take water. And even though they're traveling across the desert and they've got water with them, it's not until in Acts chapter 8 that they come to a body of water and the eunuch says, hey, look, here's water. What hinders me from being baptized? That they stop the chariot, they go down into the water, and Philip baptized him there. That's what it talks about in the scriptures. Paul relates it to the aspect of being united with Christ in his death, his burial, and his resurrection. And any of us who've ever been to a graveside service, we have probably seen a casket that ends up getting lowered down into a grave and buried and covered with dirt. And we're still waiting for that body since then to be changed and resurrected and come forth out of the grave. But in the picture of baptism, we take a person, we lower them down into the water, burying them, and raising back up, united with Christ in his death, his burial, and his resurrection as we come forth. How significant was this event? Well, remember, Jesus has just traveled 65 to 70 miles for this. He's insisted on doing it to fulfill all righteousness, to be obedient to God in all things. And then look what happens. Matthew, Mark, and Luke, all three of these gospel writers tell us that when Jesus came up out of the water, the Spirit descended upon Jesus. And the voice of God spoke. This, or you are my beloved Son, in you I am well pleased. Jesus fulfilling all righteousness by being baptized was such a significant event that the Holy Spirit of God descended upon Jesus as a sign, according to John chapter 1, that Jesus was truly the Messiah. And God spoke from heaven to further point out that Jesus, this is my Son. This is my beloved Son. This is the one I'm very well pleased because he is fulfilling all righteousness. This was a huge and important event. Jesus getting baptized. And every baptism is absolutely important. Peter preached on the day of Pentecost to repent and be baptized in the name of Jesus for the forgiveness of your sins and to receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. Saul of Tarsus, as soon as he found out about who Jesus is and he's talked to by Ananias, Ananias tells him, right there, arise and be baptized and wash away your sins, calling on his name. And immediately he was. The household of Cornelius, when they were heard the word of God from Peter, the very first thing they did was went and got baptized. The Philippian jailer and his household were baptized that night when after the earthquake and they found out that the two men were still in the prison. Galatians chapter 3, verse 27 says that when we are baptized, we get to put on Christ. In 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17, it tells us that we are new creatures in Christ. With old things are passed away. Romans chapter 6, verses 17 and 18 tell us we're set free when we get baptized. In 1 Corinthians 12, we says we enter into the body of Christ when we're baptized. Acts chapter 2, 38 and 39 says it's for the forgiveness of sins and receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. And as I said before, in 1 Peter 3, 21, baptism now saves you. Not a removal of dirt from the flesh. We're not giving you a bath up here. We're not going to give you soap and shampoo. It is by the work of God that when we are baptized and we humbly submit to Him, He saves us by an appeal to God for a clean conscience by the resurrection of Jesus Christ. No wonder when Jesus obeyed God, he was baptized by John here. The Spirit of God descends upon him like a dove. The voice of God speaks from heaven. This is my Son. I'm well pleased with Him. This event was so special that John records for us in John chapter 1, starting in verse 29. The next day, John saw Jesus coming to him and said, "Behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. This is He on behalf of whom I said, 'After me comes a man who is of a higher rank than I. He has existed before me. I did not recognize him so that he might be made manifested to Israel. I came baptizing in water.' John testified saying, 'I have seen the Spirit descending as a dove out of heaven and He remained upon Him. I did not recognize Him, but He who sent me to baptize in water said to me, "He upon whom you see the Spirit descending and remaining upon, this is the one who baptizes in the Holy Spirit. I myself have seen and testified that this is the Son of God. Behold the Lamb of God." Here He comes. When John saw Jesus that day after he had baptized Jesus and he had seen the Spirit descending upon him and heard the voice of God declaring Jesus as the Son of God, John began proclaiming, "Here He comes. Behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world." John knew he had been sent ahead of the Messiah, but he wasn't exactly certain who the Messiah was going to be. However, through the baptism of Jesus, God made it absolutely clear to John, this is that Messiah, the one you've been coming before. This is the Messiah, the Savior of the world. This is Him. He, Jesus, it is He who will save His people from their sins. Remember the angel telling that to Joseph? Matthew chapter 1. Jesus is the Messiah, the Savior, He who takes away the sins of the world. Just a moment. This baptism of Jesus by John showed John beyond all shadow of a doubt who Jesus really is. And we should never doubt who Jesus is. If Jesus had not been baptized, if Jesus had not obeyed God in all of God's laws, if He had not been baptized, then Jesus wouldn't be our Savior. He couldn't take away the sins of the world. He too would have been guilty of breaking the law of God and thus a sinner. And He couldn't have died a sinless life for us. But praise God, Jesus was baptized. He fulfilled all righteousness. Praise God, He lets us be baptized too. And John declared Jesus to be the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. And even though John was 6 months old when Jesus is born, John points out He who is coming. He has existed before John. How's that work? Well, he knew that Jesus had existed as God for all eternity. He came down to be God in flesh, dwelling amongst us. But in the beginning, as John 1:1 says, in the beginning was God, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And he goes on and explains how Jesus is God in flesh. John knew this, and when the Apostle John writes the Gospel of John, he brings this up several times in that first chapter about God's, or Jesus' eternal existence, His equality with God, His incarnation, God dwelling in human form, and all of this should prove to us over and over again that if God in human flesh saw this great need to be baptized, to be obedient to the Father God, then who are any of us to say, "Nah, I don't need it. Nah, I'm not going to do it." What makes any of us think we shouldn't? John pointed out that the baptism of Jesus was further proof, proven by God, with the Spirit of who Jesus is. If we have any doubts about who Jesus is, read the Gospels again. Read again about the baptism of Jesus, the Spirit of God descending upon Jesus as a dove, the voice from God declaring Jesus to be God's Son. Can you believe it? Well, if you believe it, have you acted upon it? Have you followed through? Have you fulfilled all righteousness in repenting and being baptized in the name of Jesus for the forgiveness of your sins and to receive the gift of the Holy Spirit? And if you're refusing to repent, then I tell you this much. Why don't you listen to John's message to the Pharisees? If you don't want to repent, why are you here? It makes no sense. Don't get baptized. But if you're willing to repent, if you know who Jesus is and willing to repent, why not be baptized? Why not listen to Ananias and arise and be baptized and wash away your sins, calling on his name? What are you waiting for? I'll tell you this much. You don't have to walk 65 to 70 miles to the baptistry. Maybe 65 to 70 steps, but not 65 to 70 miles. What are you waiting for? Will you follow the example of Jesus? Lord, I am so thankful for the Scriptures. I'm so thankful that we can study them. We can see what you did. And Lord, help us to fulfill all righteousness, being obedient to you in all things. Lord, let us not be stubborn and object. Let us do what you've called us to do. Thank you, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen.